Hello there. It's Thursday evening and we're going to continue making Sons of Sol Crow's Nest. Almost forgot the name. Don't think anyone's logged in yet, but I'm just going to start anyway, and you can be coming in or watching the VOD later. So what we did the last day, just to recap, which kind of we're moving on from now, we don't have to go back to, at least not at the moment. Hang on, didn't want to show you that yet. Wrong scene. It's also kind of the wrong scene. No, it's the right scene. Just have to turn something off while it doesn't distract us. So this is what we did the last day, the radial menu for orders. And the problems we were having were when there are no wingmen. That's one problem. We set up a scriptable object for all those icons that you're seeing there, which is in scripts, scriptable objects, icons. And we have references to all of these. So then when there are guys in the scene, you can order them about in your squadron. And the problems we were having were that these would come in rotated instead of upright, because essentially the object that's here is kind of anchored here. That's like one game object, and the one that's here is the same one, just rotated, so that number 3 wouldn't have come in upright. So we had to do some stuff to make them come in upright, and all these orders come in upright. That's the gist of what we did last time. This time, I also didn't I showed, but didn't. We didn't develop the Sol Ed editor that I'm working on, which is essentially an in-Unity spreadsheet that I'm just working up for myself, just to make it easier to have craft stats. So I've only been working on fighters. I haven't. You can see nothing available for this option. Hurry up and finish making it. But it's the first serious editor window I've done for myself in Unity, and I figured out how to get a nice swish background in there. That's part of this window, not anything else. I can change the background to anything. So just put in a picture of the galaxy for now. And I don't know, it sort of came alive when I got the ship icons in next to the name, so I could really, sometimes I was putting in stats for the wrong one. But with the image, it's much clearer which one you're talking about. I also added delete individual lines and copy individual lines, which is handier than just always adding or removing the last one. Excuse me, I'm trying not to sneeze. And this special ship code is, you could put in a string for example. And if I just wanted someone with like loads of health, but none of the blue bar health, and no ability to dodge, then I have this guy here, and because he's got a special string in, he's not level 3 now, he's special. Actually, there's something I can do. He should be level 3, not level 4. He's in the 4th place, so I've given him level 4, but it means there is no level 3. I was intending to keep the special ones at the bottom, if you know what I mean. So copy that. Undo level 3 from him. Now there's a level 3, but he's level 5. There's special. Copy him, he'll be level 4. Special's now at the end. But yeah. So just say someone with 50 health and no dodge abilities on a Mantis enemy fighter. Just gonna dock that a bit smaller. So here's the Mantis fighter at. I think I've also given him no ammo. Hardly fair. He's enough health that he might get out of there. Not if I missile him. And that's that. You should probably give him back some ammo. Right. Yeah, the prefab does have ammo. And he's no longer the special ship because I reverted to the prefab. Okay. So I'm going to turn them off again. I'm just going to show you something. The goal for the next 2 weeks and 1 day, so I guess this stream and the next 4 streams, is to get a playable public demo ready, or at least downloadable one. So that's what I'm going to focus on. So I'll start by showing you the old demo, actually. I planned to do that. You can get this on retroneogames.com/SOS Crow's Nest, which I'll just put in the chat. And there's a download. You'll have to copy paste that. It didn't hyperlink, but in the chat. At least I don't think it's going to hyperlink in the chat. But you can download the build I'm about to play from there, and it's one from July. It's the last build of the old art before Fred Mangan, the artist, came on board. So where's these builds? So, yes, right monitor. So I have to decide what to keep and what to get rid of, like how to improve this older demo. To a large degree, I can reuse it if I want to, but we can make a better demo than it. Unity Analytics was part of it. Tell me if that's too loud or anything. I think it's okay. Just in case, I'm going to take it down a bit. Okay, so when you launch it up, this is just a self-playing scene. I'm not playing here. These are all the old ships, old prototypes, old Unity Asset Store planets. 2D space kit is a really good kit if you're looking for sprite-based space stuff. So the asteroids and the planets were from that. Drew the ships myself. So anyway, this scene is... It's working with the new art as well, but it just sort of opened up so that if you're at a public demo, you know, members of the public walking by and just a laptop or a screen out on a table, that a screen, if no one's playing it and the screen's just static, it's boring and people walk past. Whereas if they see movement, you know, it attracts your eye and you look at this and you see, oh, what are these guys doing? What do I do if I play this game? It looks like the best game ever, you know? That's hopefully what they're all thinking. So obviously it says demo mode down there. It says press escape, or the new version also says press start if it detects that you've got a gamepad. But yeah, it'll restart itself every 90 seconds so it doesn't get too crazy, like too many bits of debris and like clog up the physics calculations or whatever. Though they do die, but look, it's just to reset and keep all the ships close. So then you press escape and you'd get the menu, new game. Now the character pool is working in editor, but there's a Unity bug that it loads the scene additively. So the character pool scene lets you create your own character, and then you'll see them as your wingmen in the game, which would be fun for people, and it all works, but it won't work in a build. There's a Unity ticket open for it. It'll be fixed sooner or later, but for now it's not working. I might just, if I want that feature in, I'm going to have to not load the character pool scene additively. I'm going to have to just go to it, but originally I was layering it over this, which was kind of nice, like this scene keeps going, but we can't have that for the build, most likely, because unless Unity patches it and releases a new version in 2 weeks, not going to count on that. So the character pool is simply disabled for now, but we might be able to get there in the next 4 or 5 episodes. But since it's a problem, since it works my way and when, or since what I did should work and a Unity patch will fix it at some stage, I don't know if I need, if I'll take the time to do work that doesn't need to be done by me. Unity are doing the same work, you know what I mean? So anyway, there's a link to the website, there's quit, there's no save game. Yeah, I have no options, so just, you go new game. This is the demo you play. And my first thing I'm going to do is get rid of any text up front. I don't know if people ever read it when they downloaded the game at home, but I've never seen a single person read it in a live demo, like in a convention or whatever. This is also the part of the old UI you're seeing here. So you look at the controls, and I deliberately rested the selection above this button instead of the begin button, so that people would have to see this unless they actually read it and read the word begin and avoided it. And mostly they just kind of tap A to, in most games that'll just go, so they just tap this, saw this, maybe looked at it, and then tap begin. There's also keyboard controls if that's what you're using at home, but I always bring the gamepad when I'm showing the game in public, so that's what people use there. You can begin, and you know, I'm telling you how you can do a craft loadout. And whatever about a demo you play at home, where it's quieter, you might take the time, you're not with your friends, you might take the time to read a bit and learn more about the game. No one reads in public. I don't want to make a different public version and a play-at-home version of a demo that won't even really be a game level. It'll be a kind of example level without, you know, it's a waste of time to build levels you're not going to use, and that's what I'm going to be doing. But it's a space game. It's not like building a level design with corridors and stuff. It's not that bad. So anyway, that explains things. This explains dodging, because nobody was dodging, and it's like the most important mechanic in the game for living. Like, you shoot and you dodge, and that's the loop. But no one read that either, so you get to here. And if you do nothing, that hint comes up there. Press up arrow to accelerate. Actually, I'm going to use the gamepad, and as soon as I touch the gamepad, it'll detect, but you don't have the icons for right trigger, just says right trigger. So press that and accelerate. It knows I haven't shot yet, so it'll tell me to shoot. Now if I have shot, it won't tell me that. Press B to dodge. So I now know that I can trigger to move, A to shoot, and B to dodge. And those are the things you need to know. There's lots of other buttons, but once the game knows that you know those buttons, that's when enemies will spawn. There's a return to the convoy hint. And I don't know if you can hear it, but it goes, gives a little bleep, and then the hint comes up around here, that box that comes up here. But again, I noticed nobody who played this demo ever seemed to read the hints. Like, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of asteroids. The asteroids are hurting them when they float by them without dodging. Like this. No, wait. Not like that. I need to get rid of my blue health first. Okay. Float by that, and that'll hurt me. A lot, actually. Nowadays, it only does one damage to the whole health, but in this build, it did 3 if it was a big one. So I'm halfway dead from one collision. So there's a lot going on for a new player. There's a lot of big ships, and you're wondering, can they hurt me? And hopefully, quickly enough, you realize they're not firing. If you read the description, you'd know you're escorting them, but no one read that, as I said. If you look at the radar on the top left, you can see blue and green colors tell they're pretty friendly. So then you don't worry about the big ships, but you've still got fighters coming in, and a brand new player isn't really used to looking at the radar. So it's kind of dumping you in a mid-game situation, and this player is their first 10 seconds playing the game, so that's not an ideal demo. It'll turn people off. Like, a weakness this game has is a weakness of, like, that more complicated games will have. Like, if you took Total War to Comic-Con or something, people would just, like, press a few of the buttons, move a few of the troops around, and unless they were already a Total War fan, they'd be like, yeah, this is taking a long time, and I'm not really sure what I'm doing, and they'll walk off because Chewbacca just walked by, or, you know, like, there's so many distractions at a convention. So there's lots of things I've learned in showing this old build back around June. And earlier builds of it, than it, where I learned things that I didn't actually implement, like taking away all that text. All right, so what this mission actually does, if you heard that, it was mission complete, basically. The convoy says they're clear. So you start around down here, and once the convoy gets to here, you win. So you don't actually have to do anything. You don't have to kill a certain number of enemies. You just have to survive till the convoy is safe, which is an easier kind of objective. So I'm happy enough that I got the mission objective right for newcomers. They don't have to accomplish anything other than living. And towards that end, I'm going to turn down how many asteroids are in the scene. So anyone who is out there, particularly if you have played this, but any pointers on for the next few episodes, I'll probably just take input on what's a good idea for a public demo, or if you play the demo, what's the first thing you noticed about the game that was, or what do you think should have been immediately clear but wasn't, you know, particularly in terms of controls. And equally, like, what's your favorite thing about the game? What's your least favorite thing about the game or the demo, you know, from watching the demo, from playing the demo? and then I've only seen one or two people actually beat the demo. Like, a few people get to hear. But then it's telling you hints every few seconds might come up again to call for extraction. There. So if they ever read this, call for extraction with the radio, it says. Radio's down here in the bottom left. And all of the D buttons indicate open a channel. So press any of them. Press down for... you'd be experimenting with them. If I pressed up, I'd realize I just ordered the wingman to do something. I might go back, press tactical, and press extraction. Yeah, there. Also, that old menu timed out, and it was the only way to reset it was to wait for the timeout. So I'm much happier with the new radial menu. So then once you've called the extraction, you have to fly near it, and then the dock command comes up in the radio in the bottom left, but only when you fly near it, and only for a limited time. And, you know, people miss that. It's kind of the best I had at the time, but the radio needed a total overhaul, and now we've kind of done that. So I pressed the dock button, so we're docking. And now I press the down button to leave. All the while, the hints system is, it's pretty intelligent for what the demo was. It tells you a lot. It detects intelligently whether you've done a thing yet, and it won't hint you for what you've already done. I thought I just pressed quit. Oh yeah, quit to the main menu is what it did. So that's the old demo. So what we've got to do is make a new demo and make it a lot more accessible than that was, but also show off the game. So I'll show you the last thing first, just because it's quicker. All right, so having this scene here, that old convoy, these ships, just from the demo you saw a second ago, the exact same, same ships in the same formation. Then I've got some early new art for the new versions of those ships, so I just lined them up mostly to the right. I think I've overlaid some of them. Lined them up next to their counterparts, should be... No, not entirely correctly. Anyway, if I restart, turn off the old ones, and now I've just the new ones. So, like, there's your... the cargo ships down here, a new version of that in the Art Deco style. These are early versions now. Here's an idea about a cruiser that I'm flying over now. So it was a nice long ship was a good excuse to get an Art Deco skyscraper look in there. Ships don't always travel from bottom to the top, so it'll rotate. But in this view, you can sort of tell the skyscraper thing about it. And there should be a carrier up in front. Small enough carrier. Escort carrier, I'm calling it in my head anyway. Yeah, so... I've had to enlarge that, which is why the grain looks off. But these are just sort of the shapes and sizes I'm playing with here. So hopefully we'll have... you know, a near enough finished version of at least one of these ships in the demo so that we can get this nice effect... So even though it's a 2D game, I like playing with this parallax, saying here's some nearby ships, here's some faraway ships. And particularly when they're the same ship, it's the near and far scale works a lot better for the parallax. Like here, this on the right there, the big cargo ship and the little cargo ship, you know they're the same size. Because they look identical, but that one's farther away. So I do like the effect we're getting there. So it won't be today, but hopefully we'll get... It'd be nice to have two, maybe just one type of ship, and then we'll have four or five of them in the scene. Probably do another escort mission like in the last demo, because it's... I didn't put like enemy bombers in or capture mechanics, so it's pretty much just survive until the convoy gets there. I mean, it's good enough for a public demo. You don't need to comprehend a lot of what's going on to understand, stay near this until something good happens. You know, essentially, it's that easy, which is what you want when from a demo level of a game where you're not going to be good at the game for good at the game for about 3 hours, 4 hours. You're not going to ace it by then. Until then, so to try give a flavor of everything in the first mission is what we're trying to do out of this demo. The other thing is that warp in mechanic. So now I'm going to start talking about the start of the level again. All right, sorry, I'm going to have to go back to the build. So no builds, and just show the first few seconds of it. So what we have with the warp mechanic, just because the way we're doing the new art, what we were doing before with warping probably won't work. New game. So this thing, there's a lot of parallax going on there for planet-sized things. You see, if I head towards that giant planet on the right, it actually does move on screen, but a tiny amount, because it's meant to be a big, big planet. So you only actually see that movement significantly during the warp phase, where you're actually traveling really fast. One more time. You see both planets kind of moving on screen. The far away one moved even smaller because it's meant to be gigantic, whereas this lower one was meant to be a bit smaller. And you can... I lied one more time. I like looking at it. The nearby one is smaller because it's moving... Or it's moving faster because it's closer, but it's actually also smaller. So the way we're going to probably do this warp effect in the future is more like blank out the entire screen and have a warp effect that kind of always looks the same no matter where you are, where you're going. which means losing a lot of that parallax if we do it entirely that way. So what I'm just playing with at the moment, and it'll be a case of seeing if the art works in this way, But what I was doing sort of this afternoon, and what we'll continue to do now a bit, was I was playing with a far away zoom. So instead of warping into the level, and we won't have the new warp ship ready by the demo either, so there'll be no warping mechanic. But I just wanted to do some sort of fly-in to the player like this. So I've just kind of duplicated the planet and set it smaller back here. And like, here's a pretty small one nearby that we're actually going to pass. We'll pass through an asteroid field that's identical to the one you kind of fly over later. Like, this is the one in the game level. And here now we're above it. And this is, if the asteroids were spawning, this would be essentially the new art, but the exact same as the demo. It's actually the same size. Actually, no, is this a circular one? I think it's a circular asteroid field. But anyway, it's same diff. So I was going to continue that effect for a little bit. There's an RTS camera. I'm going to go to the scene that's not... Or actually, yeah, it'll be okay. I've just set up a new script to do that zoom. I'm going to turn it off, and we should just be... Just start on the player as normal. Okay. So when I activate this map... which I've shown once or twice. Didn't happen. So it's this one. So make sure that component is on when we get there. Oh, I don't want to be max screen. It should be on. Oh yeah, it sort of is. The zoom isn't working. I'm rolling the mouse wheel, which should zoom it. The zoom is not working at all. And actually, I shouldn't. Yeah, there's a few things wrong with that. Which the menu, I believed I had fixed, but I must have just changed something today. Okay, so I have an RTS camera script anyway that handles sort of panning and zooming, and there's also a function in it. Can I turn that on? No, I don't want that on. It's the main camera? Yeah, I don't want that on. I just do want to look at the script though. Let's put down the gamepad. Right, where is it in here? I was going to show... Lost my train of thought for a second, sorry. Yes, okay. So there's a function down the bottom of this, set auto move target, and... I do it in the update, so I'm just setting that I am moving, the start time, start position, where we're going, and how long it should take, and then in the update function. If auto moving, we're going to lerp from where we started to where we're going over the time. Right. And now, but following all that, are all these things for, like, I called it RTS camera because that's how it started. There is like I probably will have that map be somewhat strategy-ful, but not as much as when I named the script. But things like left click dragging the mouse or dragging the screen around, or if you hold right click and pan, it'll do that for you. But I'm not preventing that, or even moving the mouse into the corner of the screen to start panning. If I do any of that, I think, while we're doing this zoom, it breaks. So if I move the mouse to the corner of the game screen. No. Well, definitely if I right click pan. Or left click pan, it just stops its zoom. And by now, we should have been there by now, but we're just stuck back here. And so I want to prevent that from happening. Don't want the player to be able to wreck the intro and never see the ship, and that's the end of the game straight away. So what I'm thinking is if I put a return in here, like this is the RTS camera script, so if the camera can't move, we return and we don't do any moving, but that's usually true anyway, so we don't return here. If auto moving, we're going to do the slurping. And if we're not auto moving, we won't hit this return, but if we are, we're going to do that bit of a lerp, return, and I just want to make sure there's nothing after that return in update that would have been crucial. It's just zooming. Yeah, these are all just different versions of moving the camera around. So with the return there, I'm going to try break the approach. I'm going to left click drag, right click drag. Roll the mouse wheel, move the mouse into the corners. Yeah, okay. So that seems okay. Now, the second problem, I think once we get here, the script is still on the camera, so I think I can right-click pan now, yeah. And the script that controls the camera following the fighter is on, so it's bringing it back to here when I release, but essentially, I don't want to be able to do this either, so I'm going to have to turn off the script once we finish that zoom. In every scene, I have a director. I have a manager with sort of all the tools for detecting input and doing things like blackening out the screen. The AI is in here, or at least the AI commanders for each side are in here. Every scene has audio manager, director, manager, and at the moment it has to be called fancy background. There's nothing wrong with that, but it has to have some sort of background elements in there, or anything you want has to be under fancy background. So on the director, which is always there, I've added this script, which is specific to this level, just the zoom intro. So I'm actually moving 5,000 units back in the Unity game scene, so it is a long way. We're traveling over 15 seconds. That's probably a long time to start a game demo, unless you have some awesome stuff happening. Just for now, I'm gonna turn that down to 10. Zoom. Right, I'm gonna call this finished zoom. So I wanted to do more than just turn on the speed particles. So this is everything I want to do when finished zooming. Camera.main.get. Or do I already have it? Yeah, RTS cam. I already have the script I was about to get a reference to. So the RTS camera script.enabled is false. I'm just going to leave the speed particles on so you can see what that was doing. They're for giving you a frame of reference as you move your ship about, but you don't want them on in this approach because it just looks like brief snow. We're moving too fast for it, and it's also sort of set up for 2D, not 3D. Like, this is what it should look like. Those little white flecks of dust just giving you something to move against so you get a better sense of movement than nothing. Space is hard to perceive distance in, so anything you can do. Games always put in space dust. Usually looks like star streaks, but obviously it's, you know, it's only one star nearby and it's the one behind the planet. These little bits aren't stars. Neither is pretty much anything you see in a game when you're thinking of movement effects. But they look the same. Anyway, space dust. So I'm going to turn that on. And now there's an issue here that's easily fixed, but not right now, and that's that this is the planet I've had in the scene a couple of weeks longer. The scene is generating its own color every time I play, you might have noticed. For the moment, I don't really care what color it is. Scriptable objects. Appearance. No, that's for people. Environment. So there's four colors that the scene might take when it starts. And it'll color the background element in that color, and it'll color anything in the fancy background child, so planets, as actually planets and that geometry, that panel. it'll color that with it. But if I was to also color that sun, corona, is that the right word? The halo effect around behind the planet, if that was colored as well, then it's just far too much green. Or any one color, like it's far too much of one color. Which is why I left that corona white. Not gray, white. Wrong object. That one. I left it white. But I don't actually have I don't have the halo as a separate object here. Yet, so I just have the planet image features the halo. So if I recolor the planet, I recolor the whole image. But you notice it's fine when we're in the editor because it's just grayscale, it's black and white. So the white is white, but when I recolor it, it's just wrong. So we need to get just essentially to get the artist to give me a separate layer of the halo effect on these planets. So that'll be one problem that we see straight away that can be fixed with just an asset. And another problem is that I'm actually a bit too far back because the geometry is obviously, now that's as close as I should be, right? Because otherwise we're seeing the black lines on top and below. How is this too fast an intro, you know? That time it didn't actually come all the way in. It's very specific Z distance that it's at. -47.38945. So I know it's not something I set somewhere to be manually -48.37. Anyone who's there can give me a shout on how's that looking. I'm going to maximize it next time I do it, actually. But how's the effect overall going? Are we getting too close to that planet? As we pass it, because you can see, as you get closer, you can see the sort of pixelated imperfections on the edge of it. Like now, But it's not too bad. It's very brief. I think 15 seconds is long for an intro. So I think we're starting further back than we need to. It's nice to fly through that asteroid field, I think. Then come up on another one, and then just... There you are. The reason I'm restarting now is I just suspect that the time it didn't zoom all the way in was because it was a restart and not a fresh play. Like fresh Unity play. No, that's fine. So, reproduce. Finding that bug will be fun. Okay. So 15 seconds is too long and we're starting too far back, but 10 seconds if we started a third of the way closer, so what's a third of that? We go to roughly 3600 back, and 10 seconds. Let's see how this is. Yeah, seems okay. I mean, there's certainly more we could be doing with that, but I mean, that's an effect that I've prototyped, and I've spent a bit longer now because I'm live explaining than just if I'd done it without being live. But essentially did that, let's call it a half an hour total, pre-stream and just the last couple of minutes of showing it. And I could tweak it forever, but I mean, it gets the point across, so I'll discuss with Fred whether it's a right or wrong kind of direction for the game's visuals. But I think it might be nice to start the demo that way. And at any rate, if it's not, all I do is uncheck that box and we start the demo this way. Right. Easy enough. One thing I do want to try, though, just out of something, is that the one I want? Yeah. It's going to create an empty game object to hold 3 transport ships. I'm going to duplicate that, bring it here. Duplicate that, bring it here. And do I have an engine sort of trail? Actually, yeah, without duplicating them, should have put a trail on first. With a ship engine, the fighter engine, animation thrusters. Just gonna copy that, put it on this guy. Yeah, scale of 0 is why I can't see it. Actually, it's going to have to be bigger. Bigger still. Not going to waste much time doing it. Okay, so that's a ship with a bit of an engine. There's one that we put over here. And there's one we put... Actually, I'm just going to get rid of the minus and then it'll be on the right. Okay. So there's 3 ships. Now this game object, I kind of want to put this halfway between where the camera starts and where the camera ends. So about 1800 minus 50 minus 300, that should run straight into it because we're using just a linear thing right now. Actually, can I copy that? No, okay. I'll go 50, 300, 1800. Actually, I'm going to make it 310. Actually, no, I'm going to 290. Just because I don't want to fly through the ship, but like to avoid it, you know, by a tiny amount. Let's just see. Oh yeah, I turned it off. Director, turn back on the zoom. I just felt like there was one too few things that we passed. It's a very small kind of thing that's going on, but on my screen, so I'm not sure if it's because it's small, if it's translating through to Twitch. I think you can see it anyway. I say Twitch. We're on Twitch, Beam, and YouTube Gaming. But the white lines are looking a bit weird, but you know what? I do have a mover. I'm going to put a little lower, minus 350, add basic mover script. I just want them to move up at a speed of, actually, 6, say. Every second you'll move 6 units forward, so I might just give a bit of an impression of movement on this. Even though we're going by really fast, it might just improve. And it took me 10 seconds to do. Okay, it didn't change much, but... what bothers me is that you can see those ships from seemingly very far away. So just have the size of them, but... yeah, actually, that... so I'm gonna bring it a bit further up. But at this half scale... that was a bit too far up. Try it at normal scale again. Yeah. See, I don't exactly like the fact that you can make out exactly what they are from the first second, you know? Here you're like, oh, what's that? Are we getting... oh, yeah. Oh, there, okay. So... yeah, kind of like that. I'm not going to put them that far back, though. I think I'd like to be 3/4 of the way there, maybe. So that'd be... minus 900... three or so. What's the other one? 800? What's the third? 600. So minus 200. That's what I want for that. So we won't see them until a little bit later in the approach. I can see where they are. They're tiny, way up ahead. Yeah, I think I like that better. Now I nearly wanted to be... we're seeing them in the last third of that approach. I'd nearly like to see them in the first third now. Or at least for this to be something like a Discovery Channel thing, and it takes a lot longer to get in, but... yeah, I don't know. I can do all that sort of adjustment later. So that's the convoy there. Fancy background. Yeah, we need to remask some things. Once we're in, like we've passed an asteroid field, and the asteroid field is a lot of particles, and it might be generating asteroids, actually. Didn't even really check that. Didn't notice as we flew through. But anyway, what I want to do is turn off the asteroid field after we pass it. As well as that convoy. I'm not going to see them again. So I'm just coming up a list of game objects. Yeah, public. For each game object, OBJ in objects to turn off. Destroy OBJ. I should do it. If you destroy something in a list while you're going through the list, you can cause problems. But actually, a good tip for doing that is if you go through the list backwards, so you go for I equals 0 in a for loop. But instead of I equals 0, you put I equals the last number, the length of it. And then instead of I plus plus, you go I minus. Then you can destroy stuff on your way through the list because you're done with it. And then you move on to the previous one instead of moving on to the next one. So the list doesn't get shorter. So the end point of the list, you're heading towards 0 instead of heading towards an ever-changing end point. But you're always heading towards 0, so if you're coming down the way. So it's a tip, go backwards through a for loop if you want to destroy or remove things from a list as you go through it. So what I want on that list is the convoy. Convoy and second asteroid field. I think that's it, actually. Could add that other planet, but had a thought which I was sharing in a second. Okay, now we're here. Are those things gone? Convoy, asteroid field, yeah. I'm just going to set them inactive. Set active false. Yeah, objects to turn off. That still works as a description. Just in case I feel like doing the mission and then flying back through the same stuff. I could basically reverse the intro. Right, now the... What's the next problem with this, if anything? It's pretty, yeah, the fact that we don't slow down towards the end is a little, it's jarring, but I mean, that's a level of polish, I guess. And it's just a math equation anyway. But yeah, I'm gonna leave it for now. Okay, so we've, oh yeah, the UI is on. Essentially, we'd like to come in like a bit more like this. No UI on. And then, yeah, I think 10 seconds is enough for, and then sort of turn them on, but probably instead of turn them on, like slide them in. Hello to whoever joined recently, whichever channel you're watching on. Do say hi if you've got an account. Also, we can put your name in the game as on a list of NPC character names. So just give a shout out with your name in the chat if you want. I'm going to spell it in a weird sci-fi way, But if you type your name in the chat, we'll put the name in the game. First name, last name, or nickname, call sign. All of that. It's fine. I'm not going to put in, like, horny boy 62 and stuff. Obviously, this is going through me, a human brain, so I'm not just allowing people to type in the names that'll go in the game. That'd be a terrible idea. But yeah, that is a service we provide. Name in a game. So, right. We've zoomed in. Did the blackout... There's a black kind of fade in from black to clear should happen. Yeah, it's happening, I think. Yeah. It's a bit quick, though. Where does it happen? I believe it's the director... Alright, so I've actually hard-coded that in a while ago. 2-second fade-in. So, obviously it'd be preferable to... Just make it alterable in the inspector per level as well, instead of just always two. Where'd it go? Yep. Yeah, and I'm gonna try and make that maybe 4 seconds when it appears here. Purple's a bad one to see. Yeah, it's okay with me. Just something else I could do quick is so I just set that to, instead of false, I just set it to the act, that's the opposite of what it currently is. So if it's on, it'll go off. And if it's off, it'll go on. So what I can do is add the UI to that. So when it turns off the other things, it'll turn on the UI. It might be a bit sharp, but it'll do for now. I just have to turn the UI off at the start if we're using that intro. Yeah, director.instance. The way I turn them off, I just have the numpad here. I can toggle things on and off with the numpad, like any game object in the scene that I drag in here. So essentially, I want to turn off toggle objects. I have them laid out like the numpads. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So I want to turn off 4 and 7... 3, 4, 7. Yeah, 3 and 6 are the same. So 3, 4, 7. And now leave the timer on. Okay. Oh, it says left panel, right panel, and radar. I'm going to lock that. Okay. So I can multiple select right panel, left panel, radar, drag into objects to I changed the name to toggle, though, instead of turn off. That doesn't clear the list, will it? Ah, it did. Almost thought it didn't. Okay, so we also needed the asteroid. And... damn it. Convoy. So at start, I want to turn on... Yeah. Just the first three. I want to turn off the first three items in that list. I is less than three? Is it less than or equal to three? If it's equal to zero, less than three. Zero, one, two, three. Zero, one, two. Yeah, should be okay. I plus plus. Objects to toggle. I dot set active. I'm gonna set it false. Sorry, and the reason I haven't just turned it off here myself is, for one thing, because I don't want to mess with this prefab. It's in every scene, so I'd rather that the director that's specifically for this level does stuff like that. Another reason is just if I don't use it, all I have to do, if I turn off the UI in the hierarchy, I'm going to have to turn it on when I decide not to use it. Whereas at the moment, all I have to do, if we're not doing that intro, is just turn off that component and everything will be correct. Everything's on. Whereas if I have it on, it should turn the UI off, except for the timer, which I was okay with. And the kills is on the same panel, but whatever. And now it's on. And that actually would... I know it was sudden, but it looked pretty good to me. The gold of the ship came up at the same time as the gold of the UI, so... I actually, even though I knew what was going on, I sort of didn't notice that the UI wasn't there and then was there. So while I might consider animating it in from the side and coming in to be a bit more swish, but that absolutely worked fine, at least for prototyping. Move the desk around a bit. Okay, something at the tip of my tongue there. Yes, player controls. I believe I can move and shoot and you'll hear it. Right, you can't hear the shooting, but you can hear the overheating. Yep. So, that's not ideal. Now I have a simple way to do this. But I think it's player AI logic instance, yeah. I made that a singleton. Toggle player control. Yeah, that should do it. Or do I have to give it bools? Yeah, okay, I do. Health script enabled. Won't really matter, I think. Engine script false. I don't want to move. Dodge. I don't want to dodge. Shoot. Definitely don't want to shoot. Hopefully there's nothing counting on any of that being up yet, that I get null references. Then we'll toggle everything true. Just copy paste, save. Right, now just do the same thing, and I'll be trying to move and shoot. You should hear nothing, and we should be where we start when we start, and... Yeah, you can hear a low rumbling that you can't probably hear. It's very faint. It's quieter than... Yeah, now the engine noise has come up. It was quieter this time than it was on the other approaches. Because essentially with the engine script off, it's not raising the pitch of one of the engines. And now you might have heard it a higher pitch on the engines, which is fine. It's nice to have a low rumble in space because there'd be no noise whatsoever, but except for the noise of the engine of the craft you're in. So that's fine. I'm okay with that. Okay, so if that's our intro, let's say. If Fred lets me. Because like I said, we're going to zoom past planets that are going to be seen in detail that maybe shouldn't. Like, we don't have to zoom past that planet. We could... Like, zooming past chips was kind of nice. We are already zooming through asteroids. I just kind of wanted to zoom past the planet to show we could. Because the planet actually is... Well, it's a moon, say. It's like moon-sized compared to this planet. But it's nice to move past large planetary bodies. And it sort of subverts expectations. You're like, oh, here's a 2D space game, but I'm using a perspective camera now, like sort of halfway through development. I realized I could get a lot out of a perspective camera, even though it's a game that would normally use just a 2D orthographic camera. I realized I'd get a lot of free parallax, because I was using parallax scripts, and then when I'd move something into the background, I'd be like, okay, so what's the trigonometry on this? How much parallax should I put on something that I move 100 meters down compared to the size of the camera and the camera distance? And the camera distance didn't matter in orthographic, but... So essentially one day I just laid up an orthographic camera next to a perspective camera, zoomed the perspective camera to a wide enough angle I was happy with, and then just moved it in enough until the ships all lined up with the orthographic camera. And it's like, okay, so at this distance, which is -17.3, I think, the perspective camera shows the exact same fighter distance and stuff as the orthographic camera was. And from then on, anything I put deeper into the background or closer was getting parallax for free without any calculations. Which let me get the 3D asteroid field, like, that we fly through. Now, not necessarily keeping that. Just two random clusters of asteroids in space. Does that make sense? I don't know. Is that part of the vision Fred wants for the look of the game? I don't know. I'll wait till he sees it. But I've just been alternately, like, two classes. I don't know. Am I teaching you anything? Two live streams ago, we played with the spawner in the distance. So I've just been playing with effects for the depth. Because I don't have to be stuck in a 2D mindset, even though it's a 2D gameplay space. Where's that spawner? To show you this guy. Wherever he is. Yeah, so between my crosshairs there, you can see like a shooting star. We did this 2 episodes ago. And that's just bringing an enemy fighter up from the background. Moving him, once he's on your level, he wants to kind of spawn in off screen, so we move the trail towards a point off your screen, and that changes depending on your movement, and then he spawns in, and that's a way to play with depth from the other direction, whereas I can just spawn him off screen on the same Z equals 0 plane and move him in, or I can subvert expectations a bit and play with the background. So yeah, I was just going to say, if you have any good examples of 2D games that played with the background a bit, Fez is a great example. Nothing relevant to this in that example, but it's a great example of subverting 2D expectations because we have the technology. And it's fun to play around and just exceed expectations. So yeah, this new intro is just me doing that, and I've sort of taken enough time about it for this evening, I think. I want to make it I want to slow down towards the end of the approach. I would like the planet to be less grainy as we pass it, or just move it further out of the way, or get a higher res version of one. Or actually, would MIP maps do the job? We're in the wrong scene right now. Just go back to that scene. Just had an idea. I don't think it'll help. We'll see. Planet 1, 2, 3. Which one was it? Planet 1, 2, or 3? I don't know which one's which. Okay, that's the one. So, Planet 3. Generate MIP maps for a second. It's meant to help with level of detail and sort of blur at distance, and it makes the file bigger by adding copies of the thing, like different scaled copies of the image. I'm not an expert on it, but so you still got a bit of that pixel on the angle. But without, is it worse? Haven't played around with it very much. Because I haven't really been playing around with the depth of things. I don't think there's too much difference. And this is actually just my understanding of MIP maps. I might be completely misinterpreting the use of it. I'm not seeing much difference, and it might just be because the image itself is 500 by 500. I mean, there's going to be... Where is it? Planet 3. Say if I zoom in on the actual original image, because you can't get any better quality than the original. So if I was flying by that close, see, we didn't get much closer than this. It wasn't too bad. Wouldn't have been too bad, so I don't know. Could try a higher res version of this for flying by. Fact. I turn MIP maps off again. Off again. Okay, last thing I'm going to do on this. I'm just going to change it to the bigger planet. It might be in our way now, actually. Hopefully not. Oh dear, it's going to be in our way. Yeah. God, that's a way bigger planet. See. Problem is now it's the same as this one here. So, like, scale in space without, you know, you've no way of knowing until you see some real movement how big a circle in space is. Like, is it a planet or a moon or Jupiter or Earth? What sort of size are we talking about? You know. I just want to get it so we fly by quite close to it. Without it looking too flat, which I think it may have just done. If I push it, if I make it closer, is it less noticeable? Probably not. Probably more. But let's see. Yeah, no. Definitely looks more flat there. Back one. I think that's an okay distance. Where's the other planet? The names he's using earlier. I was high or something. I wasn't, but I was not naming things very intelligently. So I want the planets to all be a different size from each other so that the movement matters. So the movement has a greater effect if they're all a different size. And that's the whole point of this intro, is just to make... Essentially, I mean, I'm probably putting you guys off, but sure, that's development. Taking 10 seconds at the start of a demo to make your player go, oh wow, that's different. So look, no one's played every game anymore. That might have been true sometime in the 80s, maybe 90s even. No one's played every game. I won't swear that this hasn't been done before, but I've never seen it. And if I've never seen it, and I go through an effort to play a lot of games, particularly space games, because I'm making one, so I want to see what else is out there. If I've never seen it, even if it does already exist, if someone's done it, there's a good chance that a lot of my players will not have seen this effect or something similar to it, and they won't go, oh, this reminds me of whatever. So this reminds me more of like a science documentary or something. Where it just zooms in through the solar system and passes all the planets and asteroids and things like that. So that's what that reminds me of, makes me happy. Definitely going to move on from that now. Excuse me. A bit gassy this evening. All the chorizo peppers. No, jalapeno peppers on my jalapeno chorizo pizza. Yummy. Chorizo peppers. I wonder what that would taste like. Okay. If anyone's watching this as a VOD and thinking I don't interact with the chat very much, I don't think there's anyone watching this evening. Hello to you watching the VOD from the past. Ooh. Okay. So, zoom in feature, disable mouse movement. That's kind of what I wanted to do. We're at an hour, 20 minutes. Normally I go for about 2 hours. That might be a bit long. I'm just getting the format together, asking viewers for advice, what they would like to see, how long shows should be. I don't really think many people go in watch older episodes. It's more about interacting live. So the question right now is just keep it a short one or do another item. We did, I did solve this off camera. I think I pointed it out and wrote it down on the last stream. The AI, when your wingmen cover you, there's a bug with that behavior. Caused by... The window edit, yeah, but I showed you the editor. The bug was caused by it was an unhandled if else thing. So the bug was that the fighters who cover you, which I can show you in the test scene. Fighters who cover you are meant to go and attack anyone who's attacking you. Now, where'd they go? Oh, I just turned them off instead of on. Okay. So these guys, the two other golden ships, will try to get on the tail of the other guy who was killed straight away. Do we still have that test one in? Example? Really strong example? Yeah, okay. So we'll say this guy is example again. Just so he lives longer. So they try to get on his tail. But they weren't. They were essentially staying where they were relative to you. Pointing towards the enemy and not doing anything. And it was because the if statement for where they should move said, if they are doing the tailing behavior, move here. And if they are doing the jousting behavior, move here. But what they were actually doing was the covering behavior, which is neither of those two things. So I just put in an else for if it's none of those things, what else are you going to do? And it set the else to be basically the same as tailing. It's probably imperfect. It means they'll never joust on covering behavior. But I don't think the jousting is necessarily for the player ships. It's more for faster enemies that I have in mind. So that's that. I'm not going to launch into doing anything with the tactical map today because that's a longer task. Also, it's... why can't I zoom? Well, we can fix a bug on it. Why can't I zoom in? Let's call it tac map script. No. Or camera tactical, it's called. That's what I was looking for. So there's a can zoom bool. It's not public. Hang on now. Oh no, yeah, it's RTS camera. That's what I'm looking for. It's on the same. It's on the same game object, so I just essentially thought of the wrong one. Alright, can zoom is true. So why can't I do it? Just want to see if this stays true. Yeah. And you can see the camera 2 size is moving when I roll the mouse. But it's not doing anything about getting there. It's probably one of the returns I put in. Could be. If can zoom. Is there any returns before here? In update. If auto moving. Oh, we shouldn't be auto-moving. Just gonna debug that. Essentially, once I turn it on, it should print test every frame, I hope. Oh, I do think I know what I did. The RTS camera script on this is sharing. Or like it wasn't sharing before, but the zoom in feature that I just did uses the RTS camera script, and I got rid of a whole lot of unscaled delta time. Thinking that I had been a noob for writing it, but no, I was a noob for getting rid of it. But it was getting in the way of the behavior on the zoom intro. Not time dot, just regular time. Okay. So what kind of happens here is you roll the mouse wheel or the right trigger, or the left trigger. And that'll sort of add to the float of the two size. What size are you going to go to? And then over time, it'll bring smooth the camera towards that size. The problem is when I go into the map, I'm putting time scale to zero. So time.time is going to be the exact same time now as it is now, as it is now. Time won't have changed at all until the game's unpaused like this. So zooming is doing nothing because time isn't changing, but you have time.unscaled time, which I guess is the same as your system clock. It's just going to keep going whether you've set the game time to nil. So there's 10, I think there's 10 places, unless one of them's a comment, but I don't need to worry about these ones. These are for something I'm not using even anymore, probably. I won't say I'll never come back and reuse that part of the code, but it shouldn't be something I use. Set auto move target. That should be fine there. So I think I don't have to worry about the last five of them. But most of these read unscaled time 2 hours ago. And I changed them before the stream came on. Just trying to start that behavior working so I had something to show. Now at the end I have to fix it. Okay. Don't think I need that one to change. Which means hopefully we're just dealing between these four. So the zoom start time, it's going to have to be the unscaled time anyway. Because, as I said, time doesn't change at all when I get to the tactical map. Only the unscaled time changes. So it's if, else if, else if. Given that they're else ifs, I imagine these also have to be unscaled. What am I doing in them? Yeah. Basically, what time is it now versus when did it start? If it's time.time, it'll be the exact same time, so it's going to have to be unscaled in all these else ifs. Yeah. Oh, I should get rid of the test debug as well. We'll do that in a sec. Oh, I did. Okay. Oh, wait. No, I didn't. Yes, I did. Did I? I don't know. But the zoom is working now. Let's make sure the other movements are working. So there's left click drag. Yeah. Right click pan. Right, hold right click and move the mouse around that point to pan. That's actually looking a little, it feels a little off to me, but it's working. Where did I find panning? I commented this well enough, so right click scrolling. I don't know, there's no time dot time or unscaled time in there, so maybe it's just me thinking it feels weird. Maybe it's because I'm not at the default zoom, which is this zoom. I don't know. It feels a bit off to me, but I'm sure I'm the only one used to it, so it doesn't really matter. What is going on here? Wish I'd commented this one. I do not know entirely what I'm doing there. Nothing's breaking. So for now, I'm going to leave that. Oh yeah, and mouse into the corner. Panning. Yeah, it's harder to find the corner in a Unity game window. Like, on a, in full screen, you just move it to the edge of the screen, but here you actually have to really find it. But yeah, that works. Okay, so back to the scene where we're testing the zoom. And I was having like a 2 second delay at the start. Okay, not having the 2 second delay. Am I getting there in 10 seconds? Yeah, okay. That I could just about read that read 10 seconds, you probably couldn't. Okay, so now the zoom works and the intro zoom. Sorry, the map zoom and the intro zoom both work. Don't need that. This, don't need that. Don't need those things for now. So I may just leave it there. I don't want to get into the map, which is what I was saying when I found that bug, because to do these things, it take a bit more going through a whole bunch of different fighters and giving them different, well, similar ways of behaving to mouse over, and that they'll draw a line to where who they're attacking or where they're going. Yeah, this is the other. This is a note from the jousting behavior, and that's okay. The bugs, radial icon for. Yeah, that's a bug we took down last week that I have not tackled. It's a bug that'll come up very rarely. I did actually put it on my other list of bugs, though. This is just for what happens in the stream, basically. So it's in the bug archive. It'll be tackled someday, if ever. It's definitely not a breaker. So it's not what I'm worried about. I doubt if it even comes up, people will notice that it was a bug. So the only other thing here is the fighters getting their stats don't change their UI boxes, which is, so here's the player using Sol Ed. If he was, let's call him special ship player, right? And we'll make a special player. The string has to match exactly, but that's okay. So if I gave him, I don't know, 7. And so it should be 7 green bars, and we should see 1 blue bar of health. Turn off the intro. Or actually, let's do it in the other scene. So, yep, player. So, let me full screen that. That was, when I pause it, stops full screen. Is there any way I have set up that I can pause without losing visibility on this? No. All right. Well, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 green bars. Go away. Nope. Go away. Okay. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 blue bars. But we're not meant to. Max situational awareness is meant to be 1. Max health was 7. So that was correct, was it? Let's change those numbers to 3 and 3. Yeah, it's definitely wrong. I think it's still 10 and 5. And so essentially, what I have is actually, it's not like five different green bars, it's just five, I'll show you, five kind of dividing boxes on one, laid over one green bar. So the health slider is just one slider. I think I'd have to be unpaused to change this. Full screen. The slider is just one slider. Oh god, someone take care of him. Good. Okay. No, I can't actually move it. The code is updating that every frame, so I can't change it, but essentially you have that slider and then just dividing boxes laid over it. Let me just stop moving. Okay. Dividing box 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I get rid of some of them, it's just one box stretched out. If I duplicate it, it's 2. And so it should be giving the correct number for how much health they actually have. And so it looks like the health bar stays where it is. So I have to actually match the amount of bars or I'll have incomplete bars, but essentially I'm just putting in empty boxes. But it's not happening correctly, but there's a lot that could be going on with that, so I don't want to start a new thing now with like 20 minutes left till the maximum stream time I normally do. So I think I'll just end this one early. So we've a bit of an intro to our demo, which is really not enough of a demo, and it's an intro we might be scrapping, but it should be a nice effect if we can get around a few art problems, which will be between me and Fred. I'll kind of report on the stream whether we're doing it or not. I'm not going to be live streaming with Fred on Skype or anything, so yeah, we'll just figure that out behind the scenes. And then what have we got? We've got 4 streams until the public deadline. So I have 2 full weeks of work, but only 4 streams in that time. So given that it's a deadline, I'm not necessarily going to save things up for this stream if they need doing. But I do have to sort of plan what the demo is going to be, which, as I showed at the start of this stream, might borrow a fair bit from the old demo, but it has to start off less complicated than that and with hardly any or no text. So essentially I wanted to do that fly-in intro, have the player on their own, let them move around for a bit and just play with the buttons. They won't get anything too wrong. Don't have any asteroids that can kill them straight off. Then a step that I haven't quite decided on, like whether there'd be a voice in your ear or you know, just a text chat kind of instructor giving you flight instructions, like this is your, could be a flight simulator or like your space driving test or something, just to try and get you used to, you know, essentially move over to this waypoint. Good, you got here. Blow up these 3 boxes. You know how games are in their tutorials. First-person shooter tutorials get a bit dull because they're actually all the same, but this game really is different in terms of the movement controls. You don't just go WASD and mouse to move around. You control it like asteroids, so unless you're familiar with asteroids, and even then there's a few new buttons, this will be new to the player. It's intuitive enough for most people that I've seen play it, but some people really just don't have a grasp on which way they're moving because reference points in space, like they might think they're sitting still. So that's why I've added 3 things like the trails on the player ship, actually on all the ships. The trail that shows where you've been, two white lines. So that helps. Things like the space dust is subtle, but it should help. What really helps is moving against a bigger object like that big spaceship there. But in space, you can't have too many of them. Need to come up with an entertaining but doable level for a complete newcomer. And the real trick with that is I'm the world's leading expert at this game. I've been playing with these movement controls at least since the first prototype, like 2 years ago. Yeah, I've been working on this game about a year and a half, but I sort of resumed work on it from a prototype from like 2 years ago. So the movement controls have been largely the same since then. So I can't look at it with fresh eyes at all, which is a bit challenging because I've known. I have like people I'll email a build to, but I'm not sitting there with their reactions either. So yeah, I sort of want to go like with a sit away from the computer with a paper and a pen and sort of write out what the first mission is. And it's not going to be like the first level of the game probably, because I'm going to try to cram in, like, while the story prologue might have you just flying in the first mission but no combat, in a 4-minute public demo I want to do a bit of everything. So it's just gonna be a pretty self-contained level, but I have to write out exactly what I want to happen. Like, that intro is, I'm happy with something like that for the intro. So that's one step down, if assuming that we're okay with it from an art point of view, or we might not fly by that planet because it didn't look perfect. The asteroid fields might have been a bit thin, might just widen them out, might be make it into a belt instead of a little cloud. Different things you can do, but I like that intro. The next step is, like, what are the first things you do when you get control of the ship, and how do you go from that to something exciting? I suppose we could warp in the convoy, warp in two wingmen for you, and start that escort mission, essentially, like the old mission. There's not a whole lot to that other than setting a go point and an end point and telling you you've won when you get to the end point, and telling you to stay near the convoy when you're not. I mean, it's all doable. It's just one or two steps getting between part A, part B, part C that I want to figure out. But yeah. 2-week deadline, that's doable. Just want to get as much in the game as possible, because this will also be the first time I send the demo like online. Might take a few extra days after anime convention, but a lot of the same anime comics. Might take a few days after that to polish the demo, but it'll be the one that goes online. It'll be the first time anyone in the world can play this look.